On Monday, Metro Manila and neighboring Calabarzon were shrouded in smog, leading to poor air quality and the disruption of classes in some areas. What's the current situation? Let's find out from ABS-CBN resident meteorologist Ariel Rojas. He joins us live. Ariel.
Hi, good afternoon, Carmina. Fair to good air quality levels are now observed in the monitoring stations of the Environmental Management Bureau in Caloocan, Pateros, Makati, and Parañaque as of 11 this Tuesday. This translates to much better visibility of the Metro Manila skylines. The improved air quality is mainly due to the sunnier weather condition which heated and expanded the air, allowed wind movement, and dispersed the suspended pollutants. Yesterday, the skies were overcast with very minimum wind movement, which allowed for the concentration of air pollutants near and above the ground. As pointed out by FIVOX, locally emitted pollution was the cause of the smog yesterday in Metro Manila. However, atmospheric scientist Dr. Jerry Bagtasa of UP said there was actually some emissions from Taal and Southern Luzon power plants that made their way to Metro Manila. The condition is of course different in Taal Volcano. So far, FIVOX still quotes data from August 15 as to the amount of the emission, the sulfur dioxide emission from Taal Volcano, which is just more than 3,000 tons daily. So far, we have no new data coming from them. But apart from Metro Manila, most of the country is also experiencing warm and humid conditions as the monsoon break continues. However, intense afternoon thunderstorms will bring moderate to heavy rains with strong winds over Ilocos Region, Cordillera, Cagayan Valley, Central Luzon, Calabarzon, Mindoro, Camarines Provinces, Barm, Sacsayhuaman, and Bukidnon, and even here in Metro Manila.
All right, a few questions for you before we let you go, Ariel. Yesterday was almost apocalyptic. You had that apocalyptic feeling, right? Mm-hmm. You knew that there was some sort of activity in Taal. The air quality was poor. Then the thunderstorms happened in the early evening. Did that actually help sort of dissipate and dilute the pollutants in the air that we experienced earlier in the day?
It actually did. Usually, heavy rains after an event of a smog event helps because it clears the air. So the suspended particles go down with the rain to the ground. So after the heavy thunderstorm in the afternoon, we have observed, as monitored by the EMB stations, fair to good quality of air after the rains.
Mm-hmm. But the pollutants are still there. We can't see it. The visibility is better than yesterday, but we're in for some thunderstorms again today.
Yes, later. But we also mentioned that the pollutants are actually kind of a constant here in Metro Manila because we have lots of vehicles, we have factories, and other plants. So it's just that meteorologically speaking, some of the conditions are just right. Yesterday we had cloudy, overcast skies. We had very, very weak winds. Mm-hmm. So the pollutants just stayed kind of hover over Metro Manila for an extended period of time. But today, since the sun is, you know, up now and it's much hotter, so the air just above the ground was heated, it kind of expanded, and it dispersed the pollutants.
Good that you pointed that out, because maybe some are saying visibility is better now, everything seems to be quiet, sunny. But then, as you pointed out, it's just always there.
Yes.
It's just that yesterday we saw it, right? And that should be an eye-opener for us.
Yes, this is also not the first time that we had, you know, a severe smog event in Metro Manila. If you remember, in September of last year,
correct,
we also had several days of smoggy Metro Manila skylines. Mm-hmm. But every day, usually on a Sunday, when we have pictures taken from Antipolo, we would see some very dark part of the Metro Manila skyline littered, if I may say so, mm-hmm, with just pollutants. Mm-hmm. We see the clear skies, and then just below, just above the buildings, there's this dark patch of pollutants hovering over Metro Manila. And that is actually an everyday case.
So if, let's say, the thunderstorms don't come, If we have more and more of the condition that you mentioned yesterday, that sort of it was like a perfect storm for it to just hover, the pollutants for the pollutants to just hover over the metro, is it going to get worse as the years go by if we have less and less of sort of Mother Nature clearing itself, or at least all these natural phenomena clearing the air?
Well, since if we will put it in the context of climate change, the atmosphere will be able to hold more water, so we will be expecting more thunderstorms.
Okay.
But at the same time, since we have this constant influx of pollution being emitted, They also trap heat, so it kind of makes our environment here, especially in Metro Manila, there's this local warming brought by the pollutants that we have. And also to add to what I said, we see that there will be, of course, more car. We have more people here in Metro Manila and in the Philippines. So we see this perhaps becoming more frequent. These are more frequent during the Amihan season when we don't have much thunderstorms, mm-hmm. Because the air is stable. That means that there's also always a hotter layer of air above. It happens always during Amihan season, so it's more frequent during Amihan. So at least for now that we are still in the Habagat season, we'll see more thunderstorms, at least clearing the air temporarily from the pollutants that we have.
Okay, good to know. Ariel Orojas, there, a resident meteorologist. Thanks again for joining us here. Well, graft charges have been filed against Philippine Poll Body Chairman George Garcia and members of the COMELEC Bids and Awards Committee over its poll automation deal with Mirror Systems. Paige Avier on the line now with details. Paige, over to you.
Carmina, former Caloocan 2nd District Representative Edgar Arise filed a graft complaint at the Office of the Ombudsman against Commission on Elections Chairman George Irwin Garcia and 7 members of the COMELEC Bids and Awards Committee this morning. In his complaint affidavit, he argued that the respondents violated the Anti-Graft and Corruption Practices Act when it awarded the 18 billion peso contract to South Korean firm Mirror Systems for the automated election system for the 2025 polls. Arise claimed that the bidding for that project was already rigged for the firm's favor, despite not having experience here in the country. He also denied that his move is a demolition job, something that has been claimed by Chairman Garcia in his previous press conferences. Arise is saying that he is questioning the legality of their move to award that contract to Mirror Systems, because he's saying that the COMELEC should not have entered a new contract since the vote counting machines from the previous provider, Smartmatic, could still be reused. However, the COMELEC earlier declared these vote counting machines, or more commonly known as VCMs, as unusable. Arise is claiming that by refurbishing these VCMs, the country could save up to 5 billion pesos. These will be refurbished on time for the next polls, and they can be reused for the elections. Now, back in April, Arise filed a petition for certiorari before the Supreme Court seeking to block that same contract between COMELEC and Mirror Systems. While he awaits the decision of that petition that he filed before the High Court, he is still confident that the Supreme Court will find merit in this petition. Arise, however, said that if the Supreme Court does not grant his petition, they have no choice but to follow. But he said he is not backing down from this complaint at the Ombudsman should the Supreme Court dismiss his petition. COMELEC Chairman Garcia has yet to issue a statement following the filing of the complaint. However, he has been saying that this demolition job's end goal is to be able to use these old machines from Smartmatic. He also told ABS-CBN Teleradio Serviso on Sunday that anyone is welcome to file a complaint, and they are ready to face this one that was lodged against the Ombudsman. Carmina, back to you.
Thanks a lot, Paige Javier, there joining us on the line. The Democratic National Convention kicks off in Chicago with an outpouring of support for Democratic presidential nominee Kamala Harris. Let's get the latest from our ABS-CBN North America Bureau Chief TJ Manotok. TJ, good afternoon from Manila.
Hi, Carmina. Good evening from Los Angeles. Well, I'm personally not there, but boy, if you watch it on television, the energy was electric in the United Center in Chicago as it is filled to the rafters, not for an NBA game, but for a national gathering of Democrats as they kick off the Democratic National Convention that will formally nominate VP Kamala Harris and Governor Tim Walz as their candidates for president and vice president in the November 2024 elections. But for day one, fireworks were already set as no less than incumbent U.S. President Joe Biden was the highlight of the night to remind America of the gains of the Biden-Harris administration, as well as calling out their opponent, former U.S. President Donald Trump, for his numerous lies. Several Democratic senators took the stage too, as well as former First Lady and former Secretary of State and 2016 Democratic presidential candidate Hillary Clinton. Clinton lauded Democratic Party's courage to once again nominate a woman to lead the country. Preceding Biden was his wife, First Lady Jill Biden, spoke about her family and how President Biden has been the same decent man she married 4 decades ago. As Biden took the stage, he was visibly emotional and wiped some tears as he thanked his daughter for her kind words as she introduced him. Biden spoke confidently and with vigor, a stark difference from his forgettable performance in his last debate versus Trump that eventually led to Democratic leaders convincing him to step aside from the race and endorse Harris. Notably, as Biden said about the talking about the positive gains and actions of his administration, as often as he could, he shared credit with his vice president. The night, though, began with Vice President Harris herself speaking briefly to welcome the thousands of delegates from before her formal acceptance speech on Friday, and she also thanked President Biden for his leadership. Here's Vice President Harris.
This is going to be a great week. And I want to kick us off by celebrating our incredible President Joe Biden, who will be speaking later tonight. Joe, thank you for your historic leadership, for your lifetime of service to our nation, and for all you will continue to do. We are forever grateful to you. Thank you, Joe. And looking out at everyone tonight, I see the beauty of our great nation, people from every corner of our country and every walk of life are here, united by our shared vision for the future of our country. And this November, we will come together and declare with one voice, as one people, we are moving forward. Hope and faith.
Carmina, this is just day one of this 5-day convention. As I mentioned earlier, Vice President Harris is expected to end the week with her formal acceptance speech, as she will finally get the formal nomination from the Democratic Party. We have with us on ground, and you'll hear from him within the week, Don Tagala, our East Coast correspondent. He is spending a lot of time with Filipinos and Asian Democrats who have trooped to Chicago as well to show their support, to join the caucuses throughout the week. And it's going to be a very fascinating week to see how Filipinos and Asian Americans are, you know, exercising their right to join this Democratic Party and to show their support for Vice President Harris and Governor Tim Walz as they march on to this less than 80 days to go in the campaign before the November elections. Carmina?
Thanks a lot. Our North America Bureau Chief there, TJ Manotok, joining us from LA.